Help! Help! Somebody let me out here! Help!
Hey, fellas. Everything's fine. Excuse me while I answer my phone.
We've been hijacked! Andy! Help! Come out here! Help! Help! Hey,
the gold's gone!
Drop him off the next town.
Help! Andy! Andy, let me out of here! Andy!
So we are in our last sermon on Elijah. And we're calling this Elijah Encore. Elijah's called back to show up again, even after last week when we looked at his translation up into the whirlwind of God. And we've hopefully, over these last couple of months, you've learned about a person that was in the Old Testament, and you're going to see how he shows up in the New Testament today. But what's helpful in studying the Bible is there are these markers, as they were. There's these people that show up, and if you know what's behind them, then what you end up saying is, oh, I make the connection. And the Bible and your connection with the Bible and reading the Bible will become much richer as you know their story. And that's going to show up, I think, this morning pretty big time. So Elijah has an encore presentation. He's going to end up coming back on the scene. And he's going to do two things for us, something he's already done for us and something he will do for us in the future. So this morning I want to get right into it. Let's look at Malachi. We're going to be in several places because remember, today we're not doing biblical theology, although what we're doing is the Bible. We're doing systematic theology. And we talked about the differences between those two last week. We get to the last book of the Bible, some 430 to 40 years after Elijah's taken up into heaven. It's 400 years before Christ will come. In fact, after this book is known as the 400 years of silence, where we don't hear from God, and we wait and await for what God's going to do next. So Malachi, he writes this. This is the last few verses of his book. Remember the law of Moses, my servant, even the statutes and ordinances which I commanded him in Horeb for all Israel. As he's closing out this time, as he's closing out this canon, the standard of God's word, he says, remember Moses' law. And then he says, behold, I'm going to send you Elijah, the prophet, before the coming of the great and terrible day of the Lord. So he mentions Elijah. And so now we're told to wait. And who are we waiting for? We're waiting for Elijah. Because Elijah's going to show back up. I have Jewish friends of mine, and just this Passover, one of them posted on Facebook that they had the chair there, the empty chair. Each Passover, they set a place for Elijah, and they invite Elijah to come. And the reason they're doing that is because they know if Elijah comes, then the Messiah is not too far behind. And so we end the Old Testament with a mention of the prophet that we talked about. And remember last week we said, when you carry over to the New Testament, we have Abraham, Moses, David, and Elijah. Those are the four top names from the Old Testament that are mentioned in the New Testament. So I want you to show you this place before we go further. There's a picture I have. This is Caesarea Philippi. Now, I want to tell you that what happened at this place, and I could have given you a wider picture. You see these little carve-outs? This is a mountain and a stream's flowing through it. And it was at this site in Matthew chapter 16 that Christ asked, who do you say that I am? Or who do people say that I am? Some say Elijah. Some say, you know, but who do you say? And it was at this place, in the shadow of these icons, these other deities that people were worshiping, that Peter said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. So the reason I want you to know that is because what's going to take place in our story right after this happens right behind here, several miles, but it's right behind up on this hill, the conversation or the event that takes place. In Matthew chapter 16, when you get to the end of the book or the end of that chapter, Jesus says something that's a little strange. He said, there are some of you who will not see death or not taste death, because from Jesus' perspective, death is just a taste. It's not a final. It's not an end. It's just a taste. He said, there are some of you hearing me right now in Matthew chapter 16 who will not taste death until you see the Son of Man in glory or coming in glory. Okay, so everybody's kind of looking. He says that statement, and then we get into Matthew chapter 17. We go right from there to Matthew chapter 17. In fact, in the book of Mark, these two events are connected together. It's all under one chapter. 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John. So he didn't take all of the disciples. He just took three, his inner core, his inner confidants, James and John, his brother, and led them up on a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured. He was changed before them. And his face shone like the sun. And his garments became as white as light. In the book of Philippians, the Apostle Paul writes about the transformation of the Son of God becoming flesh, human flesh, and becoming a servant. This is the deity becoming the servant. In this passage, Matthew is recounting a story. Matthew, Mark, and Luke all recount this story. He's recounting a story of a human flesh, a man, becoming deified, as it were, taking on the deity. Jesus was God, but this is where it's kind of like the curtains roll back. And these three guys get an inside view of him, Peter, James, and John. And behold, Moses and Elijah appeared to them, talking with him. And wouldn't you like to know what they were talking about? Matthew doesn't tell us. He just tells us that they appeared, Moses and Elijah and Jesus, all of them, they appear with him, and they're doing a validation of sort. They're saying, this is the guy. They're saying that what's being represented as gold is gold. It's not sand. See, you don't have to be an expert in metals to know the difference between sand and gold. But you have to be an expert to make a discernment about who is Christ or not. And Elijah does that. So what were they talking about? Well, thankfully, Luke in Luke chapter 9 tells us what they were discussing. Because Peter is overhearing, James and John, they're what are they saying? What are they saying? Turn it up. Turn your hearing aid up. What are they saying? And here's what Luke says they were saying. And behold, two men were talking with him, with Christ. And they were Moses and Elijah, who appearing in glory were speaking of his departure, which he was about to accomplish at Jerusalem. So what were they talking to him about? The fact that he'd have to die. The fact that Christ was going to die. Christ was going to die on Calvary's cross. And so they were ministering to Christ. They were encouraging him and talking about what he would do. And I think, you know, if there was this, look at the big picture. Look at what's going on here, the big picture. Look at the redemption. Look at how much you love them. How much you, the Father and the Spirit, love them. And look at the price you're willing to pay. This would be a tremendous encouragement to at least these three disciples after those events in Jerusalem. Well, he goes on in Matthew, and here's what he says. In Matthew 17, picking up in verse 4, Peter said to Jesus, Peter's the one with the idea. He's the one with the business plan. He's always churning. His mind's always going. Peter said to Jesus, Lord, it is good for us to be here. I'm glad you bought me. I'm glad you included me on the group. I got the VIP ticket here. It's good for us to be here. If you wish, hey, you know, I'll do something. I'll earn my keep. A buddy of mine, when we were in seminary, he paid for me to joined the YMCA so we could play racquetball, so he could beat me at racquetball. And so, and he did that. And that was just such a nice and wonderful gesture. And I found myself trying to do all these things for him. And he said, Rod, I joined the Y for you because I wanted to. You know, but Peter's like this. Peter says, oh, wow, you've given me insight. You've allowed me to come to this place. What can I do? Here's what I do. I will make three tabernacles here, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. The tabernacles of booze. We'll do something. I will put some effort forward from that. And while he was still speaking, a bright cloud overshadowed them. And behold, a voice out of the cloud said, this is my beloved son, with whom I'm well pleased. Listen to him. The voice of the Father tells him and tells the disciples, speaks to the disciples, interrupts Peter, as it were. Peter had a great idea, and it was not a bad idea. It just wasn't the idea for that moment and what needed to happen in that place. That he has a relationship, that the Heavenly Father has a relationship with Jesus, that he's loved, and to listen to him. And when the disciples heard this, they fell face down to the ground and were terrified. And Jesus came to them and touched them. He doesn't stay afar off. Here is the expression of divinity. He is glowing. And in that moment, he comes and he puts his hand on them. And he touches them and he says, get up and don't be afraid. In that moment, he connects with them. His love for them, that nothing's going to happen to him, that nothing's going to happen to them. He connects with them. And lifting up their eyes, they saw no one except Jesus himself alone. Elijah shows up. He shows up in a verifying manner. He's on the mountain. He is verifying that Jesus is Christ. And he's putting his approval and his stamp of approval and his verification and his validation on the statement that Peter had made a week earlier. That this is the Christ, the Son of the living God. And so they were coming down from the mountain, and Jesus commanded them, saying, tell the vision to no one until the Son of Man has risen from the dead. The last thing they needed was to try to circumvent or cut off the fact that Jesus was going to die for us. And so he said, wait. Don't tell this to anybody. Don't tell it to the other nine guys. I can see them coming down the mountain. We know something that you don't know, you know. It's kind of like my brother, you know. I would eat ice cream, you know, and my brother would be sitting there eating it slow, you know. And then he would sit there after I'd eaten, and I'd look over and see his ice cream, and he'd just go, you know, come on, just one bite. But it's that we know something you don't know. I think Jesus made it pretty clear, and I think they kept their mouth shut. I think they were scared. They kept their mouth shut until afterwards. And then the three of them said, yeah, you know what happened on the mountain? So Elijah validates that. Do you think Elijah knew the difference between those idols that people would worship at Caesarea Philippi and Christ and who he was? He was uniquely positioned for that. His whole ministry, as we've seen, was to speak out against Baal and the false deities that the nation would follow. So he commanded them not to speak until he had risen from the dead. And the disciples asked him, why then do the scribes say that Elijah must come first? We remember reading in the book of Malachi that Elijah's got to come before the Son of Man comes in his glory. And here's the explanation. And Jesus answered and said, Elijah is coming and will restore all things. What you know from Malachi's prophecy is going to happen. He is going to come. In the future, he's going to come. But I say to you that Elijah already came. And they did not recognize him. Who is the they there? It's Israel. It's the Not Israel as in 2 Kings type. It's the nation. It's the priest. It's the prophets. It's the religious gatekeepers. Did not recognize him. But did to him whatever they wished.
so also the Son of Man is going to suffer at their hands. Then the disciples understood that he had spoken to them about John the Baptist. John the Baptist came in the spirit, in the personality of Jesus at his first coming, at his coming to redeem mankind. He came in the spirit, but he did not come in the identity. It wasn't Elijah in his identity. It was Elijah in his spirit. He fulfilled that role of the prophecy. Peter will talk about this whole event in his book. He wrote 1 Peter and he wrote 2 Peter. And here's what he says in 2 Peter. For we did not follow cleverly devised tales. He said, what I said and what I taught were things that I witnessed personally. We didn't follow cleverly devised tales when we made known to you the power and the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. But we were eyewitnesses of his majesty. For when he received honor and glory from God the Father, such an utterance as this was made to him by the majestic glory. This is my beloved Son, with whom I'm well pleased. What's Peter referring to? Well, if you don't know, the next verse will kind of seal the deal. And we ourselves heard this utterance made from heaven when we were with him on the holy mountain. He's going to refer back to this event in the book of 2 Peter. And he's going to say, this was a validation. Showing up of Moses and Elijah was a validation of who Christ was. Well, why Moses and Elijah? Moses was a civil leader. Elijah was a spiritual leader. Moses was from the law. Remember, the law of Moses is what Malachi mentioned. Elijah's from the prophets. In the New Testament, time and time again, it says the law and the prophets testify to whom Christ is. Elijah has an encore by testifying as to who Christ is. That was a ministry of validation. It was a ministry of positive. This is the right way. This is the right guy. It's all good. It's all positive. But he's going to show up later, I believe. In the future, before Christ comes back in his glory and his power. Last week we looked at the rapture. We looked at how the transfer of power took place. And we looked at how Elijah was taken away, how Christ was the ascension of Christ. And we looked at there's a handoff. Who was on deck? The Jews are on deck. We looked at that last week. The rapture takes place, and then at least in my theology and my understanding and reading of Scripture, we have 7 years of tribulation. But during that 7 years, halfway through that tribulation, the temple is restored and built in Jerusalem. On that mount where you see the Dome of the Rock, there will be a temple there. And there'll be someone to set themselves up to be worshiped that's not God. Now, Revelation, this is halfway through. Revelation chapter 11 mentions this. And let's look at Revelation chapter 11. Then there was given me a measuring rod like a staff. And someone said, get up and measure the temple of God and the altar. So we know the temple's got to be there to measure it. And this measuring rod that they would use would be a straight rod about 10 foot tall. It was taller than any man. And when you measure something, if you're going to buy some property, what do they require you to do? Take a survey. A survey or a measuring represents ownership. So God's showing up here at the temple and he's laying a standard down. He's laying a standard that has to be met. Leave out the court, which is outside the temple, and do not measure it. That court is the court of the Gentiles. For it has been given to the nations or to the Gentiles, and they will tread underfoot the holy city for 42 months. So for 3.5 years, they're going to tread the city, 3.5 years that's left during that tribulation period. And I will grant authority to my two witnesses. Now, our job this morning is to figure out who those two witnesses are. And they will prophesy for 1,260 days clothed in sackcloth. 1,260 days. It's interesting that he uses the term 42 months as it refers to the Gentiles and the nation. But he uses the term of the number of days as it refers to his witnesses and to his children. I hope you realize that Every day of your day, of your life, matters to your Heavenly Father. When He interacts with you and when He talks about you and His relationship with you, He counts the days. He counts the moments. Think of a lover. Say, man, when Gail and I, before we were getting married, Gail was going like, we got 5 more days before we get married. You know what I was doing? We got 5 more days till we get married. Same words, completely different meanings. Completely different attitude. He counts the days. He counts the days until we're together. Every single day, your high days, your hopeful days, your victory days, your days of loss, your days of grief, He knows and understands each one of your days. And so He mentions these as days. These are the two olive trees and the two lampstands that stand before the Lord of the earth. And if anyone wants to harm them, be careful who you mess with. If anyone wants to harm them, fire flows out of their mouths and devours their enemies. They have some type of supernatural protection here, whoever these two witnesses are. Because, and we're going to see where they are here in just a second. So if anyone wants to harm them, he must be killed in this way. God has His supernatural protection over these two individuals. Remember, this is during the tribulation period. The church is gone. The church is out of there. We have 144,000 virgin Jewish men exclaiming all over the world that Christ was the Messiah. That the Jew who died on the cross way back there in Jerusalem, He paid for their sins. And they're exclaiming that. Because remember, they're on deck. The church has moved off. They're up next. That transition of power has been made. Verse 6. This gives us a clue who these two people are. These have the power to shut up the sky so that rain will not fall during the days of their prophesying. Who could that be? See, you've been here for Elijah, so you know. I think this is pretty clear that when he's describing them, he doesn't use the name, but he says, hey, who would pray that the rains would stop? Elijah. Ooh. And then he says, and they have the power over the waters to turn them into blood and to strike the earth with every plague as often as they desire. Who took the rod and turned the Nile to blood? Moses, the deliverer. So you have Elijah and Moses. And where they showed up on the Mount of Transfiguration to validate, to affirm, to approve that Christ was God, they're going to show up on the Temple Mount to say, no. Now this religion, this system that you're seeing is not the way you should go. He goes on. And when they have finished their testimony, the beast that comes up out of the abyss will make war with them and overcome them and kill them. They will end up dying. Moses and Elijah will end up dying right here. And their dead bodies will lie in the street of the great city. The great city is Jerusalem. You see, the false prophet, the Antichrist, has come to understand that there's the world power, the world in which he dominates and he controls, the world system. He knows what he's really after is not just power, but he's after something that we looked at the very first message in this series. It's a heart issue. Remember what Jeroboam did? He moved the worship from Jerusalem to Dan. He moved it to Bethel and Dan, and he moved it at those two places because he said their hearts will end up following after God. So this world system, this world order has taken place. And in Jerusalem, this Antichrist sets himself up because he's after the hearts of those that are still here. He says, and their dead bodies will lie in the street of the great city, which mystically is called Sodom and Egypt. Now, I think a better word there, and this is a proper translation of that, is spiritually, which is spiritually or figuratively called Sodom and Egypt. Where would you ever think of Jerusalem being called Sodom, a place of the flesh, and Egypt a place of the world system. The world, where we wouldn't think of that, but that's what he's done. The Antichrist has stepped in and he set himself up. And where also their Lord was crucified. So it's Jerusalem. It's that city. Those from the peoples and tribes and tongues and nations will look at their dead bodies for 3.5 days. Remember, he's referring to them in days, in terms of days. Their dead bodies will sit there. And CNN and Fox News and MSN and all the satellites will be broadcasting that. They'll just lay there. And why would they do that? Because the Antichrist wants to show. Remember, they couldn't be killed before. They couldn't die before. And he wants to show he's the man. And he needs to be worshipped. And will not permit their dead bodies to be laid in a tomb. Instead of saying, I'll get that, you know, instead of covering up, if you've ever been by a wreck or scene and they cover up the body, they do that out of respect and everything of the body. Not here. They're going to be right there. There's going to be cameras on them for 3.5 days. And those who dwell on the earth will rejoice over them and celebrate. Yeehaw! Party time. It's going to be like Christmas. In fact, he says that. And they will send gifts to one another because these two prophets tormented those who dwell on the earth. These two prophets just kept on saying, this is not the guy. This is not the guy. I'm telling you, this is not the guy. I'm telling you, this is not gold. He might say he's gold, but all he is sand. That's all he is, and that's all he has to offer. Don't follow this guy. In Matthew chapter 17, follow this guy. In Revelation chapter 11, don't follow this guy. And after 3.5 days, the breath of life from God came into them. Whoa, oh boy. And they stood on their feet. And great fear fell upon those who were watching them. And they heard a loud voice from heaven saying to him, come up here. When they went up into heaven in the cloud and their enemies watched them. Remember at the ascension, Christ is raised and taken up into heaven, and the disciples are standing around and watching him go. At the rapture, it happens like that. Boom, the church is out of here. This is a display that God does with Elijah and Moses, I believe. In fact, I just changed my belief. 3 weeks ago, Scott Sykes asked me, who do you think the two witnesses are? I think it's probably Elijah and Enoch. But having read this and studying it and all, thinking about it, I think it's Elijah and Moses here. But this is a visual display of God's power. Now people are going to have to choose. Do I believe my ever-loving eyes or not? Because the whole world is going this way. You ever see something get that momentum to where everybody's doing it? We learned about that, you know, in third grade. Definitely in eighth grade. Everybody's doing this. You know, let's just go. Everybody's wearing Converse All-Stars. We got to do that. Everybody has the smiley face. I was in eighth grade, you know. Everybody's doing this. And you know, you're weird if you don't do this. And everybody's coming along. And so this world system is engulfing people. And people are talking about how much good this person is doing. This political leader is doing so much good, and you sit there and you say, yeah, and he's helping people too, but that's not enough. He wants people's hearts, and so he puts himself up in the new temple, and he claims to be God. And then Moses and Elijah show up, and they said no, and people say, take them out, and they can't be taken out. Anybody that goes up to him, boom, there's that, boom, boom, boom. And finally, God allows it to happen. And they're laying there in the street, and the whole world is looking and talking about them. And they said, we bet on the right horse. That guy that's sitting in the temple, he's the man. We knew he had the power. He's the man. Uh-oh. And now it becomes a struggle. an inward struggle. Person's got to decide. What are they going to do? Everybody's saying and everybody's encouraging each other. Yeah, the guy, he's don't worry about that. That was probably some. Look, you know as well as I do that nobody landed on the moon, and you know those two guys didn't rise. It was all a Hollywood trick. What you see here is a grace gift of God. God is allowing the whole world one more chance. Turn to Him. Turn to Him. Look at what He's done. What more could He do? He died on Calvary's cross. He rose from the dead. He comes back and He shows up and He provides a witness to His power. The fact of the matter is, while we don't need an expert to tell the difference between gold and sand, we do when it comes to our religious affections, because we're so easily turned. Elijah makes that encore presentation of showing up, and when he does two things. He validates Christ as being the Son of God, and he warns and he validates the fact that the Antichrist is not God. Remember those two kingdoms? He shows up to give his stamp of approval on the kingdom of God. And he shows up to put his stamp of judgment on the kingdom of Satan. And you and I have to decide with our lives, where's our devotion going to be? What are we going to follow? What's the game plan we're going to follow? Who are we going to follow? Elijah encourages us to make that right choice. So I hope you've learned some things about Elijah. He only shows up in just like seven chapters of the Bible, his narrative. But his story goes on and on and on. And he is a bellwether to what God is going to do in our lives each and every day. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your gift. Your gift of people who are devoted to you. Your gift of showing up to validate how much you loved us. To prove over and over again your incredible love for each and every one of us. That love we first saw in a picture of a mother's embrace to us. We knew that we could never do anything to earn that. But we were cared for. We were loved. We were nurtured by our moms. And later as we grew up, we learned of your incredible love for us. And how we come into your family through simple faith, belief of what Christ has done for us on Calvary's cross. And you continue to love us and teach us and grow us and mature us to be the men and women who follow you, who look into eternity and see this time as a brief moment, as dew that is laying on the ground in the morning. This time is a vapor. You've given us so much more to live for. And you desire to spend forever with us. And for that, we're so grateful. You provided everything needed for us to have a forever with you. We pray that as we read and study God's word, that we would remember how you used people then and your desire to use us in the now. For it's in Christ's name I pray. Amen. Amen.